Well, congratulations on your victory for the Democratic nomination for Baltimore County Executive.
Thank you. Thrilled and honored and just still humbled and grateful to be where we are.
I know you really played the – you really handled it the right way in what was as close of a race for this size of jurisdictions you're ever going to have maybe in this country. It was that kind of close, and you handled it really well, I thought, afterwards. It would have been very easy to say, hey, there are my 9 votes. I won. But you were all in on the recount, and I think Jim Broach had a very nice comment to say about you after the fact. Tell me what it was like to go through this process, though, because you're not going to have too many elections decided by that small of a margin.
I think it's historic. Someone said to me the other day that this may have been the closest election in Maryland's history from a percentage basis, not from a sheer vote basis. So I got to say, it was incredible to be a part of. I'm an old history and government teacher. So for me to be part of an election where I can say to former students that, you know, truly you should be involved and that every vote counts has been incredible.
And it seemed in the recount portion, people knew it would be either you or Broachin. But the truth is, Vicky Ammon was only separated by a percentage point as well. It was really a three-person race at its core.
That's right. And throughout this race, we've all ran incredibly strong campaigns. And I think that both the senator and the councilwoman and their supporters should be incredibly proud of the effort that they put forward, the issues that they brought to the fore. I don't take for granted that we have work to do sort of moving forward, working hard to earn the support of people who voted for them. But it was an incredible experience. I leaned into my faith. I had an incredible network of family and friends and supporters that got me through the process. But, you know, you have to campaign the way you want to govern. And I consistently have said that, you know, every vote matters and every voice should be heard. And so you have to support not just in word, but actually be behind what you say.
It seemed like most of the attention was on Broachin and Ammon. I'm not sure if that's fair, but that's kind of how it played out on election day. Did you have a sense that you were in this thing very much? Because I think the last poll that came out had you very much in the race, mm-hmm. a three-person race, but double digits down. Did you have a sense you were in this thing on election day?
Yeah, I mean, we knew all along that we were in this race. We knew that it was just a matter of our message having enough time to sort of sink in and bake in. And, you know, as things got closer and closer to election day, we felt the momentum and we felt the surge. And, you know, frankly, it feels like it's only sort of grown since election day for us, and we're excited about that. But, you know, we've always held true that people care about good schools and 21st century jobs and government that's accessible and transparent. And it was just a matter of having enough time and putting enough effort in for it to catch on.
What do you think is going to be, let's say, the two or three biggest issues for Baltimore County heading into this general election in November?
I mean, for me, if there are two issues that I talk to people about everywhere I go, is number one, schools. And I'm the education candidate. I'm the only one who spent time as a Baltimore County public school teacher. We need a bold vision for what's possible. We have schools with crumbling infrastructure. We have needs for resources that aren't entirely being met. And that's one aspect. And then the other piece is just making government more accessible and transparent, whether that's enacting campaign finance reform, or having our council work sessions in the evening, or having more budget awards and more budget information actually posted online in a way that's searchable and people can understand what's happening with their government.
People have labeled you as the progressive candidate in the race. Is that a fair assessment of your politics, or is that just trivializing your overall message?
You know, look, I think I want what's best, and what all people want, good schools. And so I don't really care about labels. I care about getting results for the residents of Baltimore County. You know, I grew up in eastern Baltimore County in the shadow of the Sparrows Point steel mill. So, you know, it's about meeting the needs of our working families and our kids and our future. And so you can slap whatever label you want on me. I'm just here to bring a campaign to folks that talks about what we're going to do for our schools, how we're going to create more jobs like I did in the state legislature, and how we make county government more open and more responsive to our residents.
How does your experience in Annapolis transfer to being at the top of a government and being the executive of a government like in Baltimore County?
I mean, I've seen what's worked and what hasn't from that perspective as a legislator working with governors and other local leaders at the county level. You know, I think for anyone to say that they've run a $3 billion enterprise, you don't do it until you do it.
Right.
And so, you know, I think what's needed in this race and what's needed in Baltimore County is a combination, and I uniquely bring this, is a bold vision for where we're going to go, coupled with enough experience that you can lead our county forward. So I bring perspective as a dad and a husband and a former county school teacher and a former state legislator and someone who spent the last 3 years in the private sector, you know, with a PhD from Baltimore County. It just sort of that whole package, but then also building a team, because ultimately one person can't run a county government that has thousands of people. It's surrounding yourself with the right people. It's having that vision and having the energy to be out in the community, to be active, and sort of be in partnership.
We're talking with Johnny Olszewski here on WBAL, and I do want to kind of get into your background after this commercial break personally, because I think some people are waking up to this a general election coming up in November for the first time, and it's important to get to know the candidates, and I feel we're a good forum for that. But before we do that, your sense of your opponent in this, Al Redmer Jr., he came back. Based on polling, he beat Pat McDonough. Your sense in your opposition here in November?
Well, I like to think, you know, I think someone made the remark that nice guys finish first sometimes. And I think that what I'd say is that the commissioner and I have participated in dozens of debates together in forums across the primary process where they had all the candidates. And every single experience has been positive. It's been cordial. And we've been focused on issues. And so I have every expectation that as this general election continues, that we're able to continue talking about issues and be cordial in our interactions with each other.
I saw a map breakdown of the voting for Baltimore County on the Democrat side between you and your two opponents. Mm-hmm. And it is amazing how geographical it was broken down. Do you have to get and push your name into other parts of the county right now? Is that the biggest challenge you face? And I'm sure Mr. Redmer's feeling the same way, but is that your biggest challenge right now?
Well, we'll be everywhere, and I think what, you know, and just like we did for the primary, we'll continue to build an inclusive, collaborative coalition from Randallstown to Rocky Point. But what I think what's lost in the map is that under, you know, a color code for a councilwoman or senator is that, you know, in many of those precincts, we came in second place.
Interesting.
And so for many folks, you know, you sort of lose sight of that even though we won in, you know, Eastern Baltimore County and came out on top in Southwest and some other precincts across the county, that we actually did pretty well in other parts. And so we continue to share our message far and wide because we think it's something that, regardless of where you live, it will resonate with folks.
And what's interesting, Johnny, Baltimore County itself has to be one of the strangest looking jurisdictions on the planet. It is diverse. Mm-hmm. Anywhere you go, you're going to run into all kinds of people. It's an interesting place. Yeah, some of the issues that you face anywhere else are going to be there, but the map is different. It's a different layout, and that makes it maybe a quirky election to ever succeed in winning, or a quirky jurisdiction to win an election in. What's your sense of that? And, you know, there are different needs in different parts of the county.
Well, the needs are different, but the underlying desires of communities are the same, right? Everyone wants to send their kid to a school that's clean, safe, and modern with good teachers. They want to have job and economic development opportunities within their main streets and their corridors and for their family. And they want to make sure that they can get the trash picked up and that they can have their parks taken care of. And, you know, anytime they have an issue, whether it's a permit or a question about code enforcement, that they are treated professionally and, you know, have a responsiveness factor. So I think, you know, the particular needs across our counties are different, and we need to recognize that all communities aren't the same, but the underlying issue is that, you know, we all want the same thing at the end of the day.
No doubt that, especially with a candidate like Ben Jealous running for governor as a Democrat, and I don't know if you have openly endorsed the Democratic nominee there or not, it's not really relevant, but people are going to say that Johnny O is going to be more of an ideological Democrat. You know, didn't totally dismiss the label progressive. Does that matter in a county executive race, those types of things? We talked about labels, but mm-hmm. the idea that ideology is enforced when it comes to running a government.
Yeah, I mean, there's no greater place than at the local government level to put party aside and just meet the needs of people. You know, picking up trash and having new schools and addressing overcrowding and making sure streets and sidewalks are paved, that's not partisan. And so I think we have a long history in Baltimore County of being bipartisan and nonpartisan, and that's the kind of county executive I'll be. One of the things I point to is in my time in the legislature, I was the youngest elected chairman of the Baltimore County House delegation in the House of Delegates of Baltimore County. We had a 23-member delegation. It was almost evenly split between Republicans and Democrats. And all 4 years I was elected, and there's an election every year, I was unanimously elected by Democrats and Republicans alike. And that wasn't because we agreed on everything, but it was because it's how you treat people. And it's, you know, that you're willing to reach across the aisle and say, if we agree, we'll work together. And there are lots of places where we can do that. But if we don't, there's no reason not to treat people with dignity and respect and have their thoughts be part of that process.
Unlike the city, to run or to be in Baltimore County, you have to work with both sides, both parties. You have to. Unlike the city, it is more of a two-party government in Baltimore County.
Well, the results are better when you are bipartisan and nonpartisan in your decision-making. And look, I'm a Democrat, and I'm proud of the positions that we hold, whether it's on schools and the environment, but that is not a reason not to reach across the aisle and say, let's partner and let's find out ways that we can work together to solve we all have the same end goals. So
I want to ask you about, someone wrote in, a Baltimore County voter talking about the NRA, because it was a topic in the primary, mostly between Vicky Ammon and Jim Brochin. What's your sense of that? And was that even fair or relevant to the Baltimore County executive race?
Well, sure. Just to be fair, because I believe in transparency and being truthful, and it's the kind of county executive I want to be, that, you know, I support common sense gun legislation that keeps our families and our neighbors safe. But the truth of the matter is that that's not really an issue that's tackled largely at the local level. It's largely issues that are resolved and legislated at the state and national level. And so, I think what a Baltimore County executive brings to the race, and this is what I hope that we have a chance to talk more about in the general, is, you know, those conversations took away from our ability to talk about what are we going to do for our school system? What kind of approaches do we have to create jobs and leverage our anchor institutions, our hospitals, our, you know, places like Trade Point Atlantic and Sparrows Point? What specific policies can we pursue to make government more responsive and more open? We just recently had an app in terms of lodging complaints release, and that was one of the first things we called for when we launched our campaign. And so there's a lot of things that we can get into the weeds on. And if we aren't distracted by issues that are important, and, you know, I have very, you know, I have positions on and I'm happy to share them, but really focus on how we can impact the day-to-day lives of our residents.
How old were you when you went to Annapolis?
I was appointed and then elected at age 23.
That is amazing. And you're what, 35 now?
35. I'll be 36 in September.
And you have a wife and?
A 2.5-year-old daughter.
Very cool. And you said after your time ended in Annapolis, you went in the private sector. What'd you do?
So I've been working for the last 3 years for a big data analytics software company. We partner across the globe, partnering with the public and private sectors. I in particular have worked with state and local governments across Maryland to use the data we have and use technology to better inform our decision making, to root out waste, fraud, and abuse, and to better serve residents. And so that's the same kind of approach that I'll bring. We can merge that with our mission of serving people. I like to bring that approach as county executive.
And your time in your education almost exclusively from Baltimore County or from schools that sit in Baltimore County, correct?
Yeah, I took one skipped out, but was a K-12 graduate of our Baltimore County public school system. I got my undergrad as a first-generation college kid at Goucher College. Got my PhD most recently at UMBC, but I did sneak in a master's degree from George Washington in between there.
Well, Dr. Olszewski, we appreciate you coming in, and next time I hope we get you again as we get closer to November. And we can make it a lot of the issues that Baltimore County folks are facing today, and whatever the issues may be as this election heats up. But congratulations on your primary victory.
Thank you again, and look forward to the conversation.